Right, Aki Kareem here for BBTV. Got something very special this evening for you. I'm joined by Peter McDonough, all the way from Pakistan. Peter, firstly, mate, I'm used to you doing interesting things on your channel, but this one took me by surprise. Tell me what's going on.
We've got the first professional boxing fight to happen here in Pakistan, but it's special because it's for a WBC Arabian Seas title as well, middleweight title. The champion's just sitting down there now eating his dinner. I mean, fight was absolutely amazing. We'll go on to the fight in a minute. But I've come out here, as you can see, as an advisor to the whole show, which has been great. It's been hard work, but we've got it done. We've got it over the line. We've had they thought it was going to be locked down. Then it weren't locked down. It looks like it's going to be locked down on Monday here, but I'm out tomorrow anyway, so I'm flying back tomorrow.
Well, Peter, loads to talk about. Firstly, I mean, have you enjoyed your time over there, and what have you made about the actual culture of boxing and also the culture and hospitality over there?
I mean, it's a lot different to like England, but very, very lovely, nice people. Can never do enough for you. It's been absolutely excellent. And I've had a great time over here. They're calling me Pakistani Pete now. So, I've worn my clubber. You've seen me in the clothes. I've had a real, real good response. I've been on TV, national, breaking news and all that sort of stuff. And I've come back into boxing with a bang, and I ain't come back in, at your call in Bethnal Green or the MEN Arena or the O2. I'm here in Pakistan.
Peter, I love your journey that you go on. It's always something interesting. I mean, are you going to have a bit of a role in the infrastructure, like helping set up this box, the professional boxing side of things in Pakistan? And is this an ongoing role?
Yeah, I mean, look, at the end of the day, I've come over here to be an advisor. All of a sudden, I'm speaking and I'm talking. We've had a Q80 fighter turn up, basically turn around and said, I would love you to do my corner. So not only have I been roped into being an advisor, I was in a corner doing a fight for a Q80 guy, who boxed really well. It was in a great fight as well. And listen, I can't help but, once I go near a boxing ring, I want to get in it. But at least I'm not getting in it and getting punched in the mouth. It's a lot easier telling someone what to do than having to do it yourself,
Tell us about this event then that's just been. You said you told me just briefly before we started this that it was a war, like a great fight. It was Pakistan versus Afghanistan, I believe. Tell us about it, mate.
I mean, yeah, Afghanistan versus Pakistan. It ain't a massive rivalry. We know India and Pakistan's the biggest rivalry. That in the future, we're looking at getting two fighters out of each city here in Pakistan, building them up, and then the champion goes and fights someone from India or something. But, the fight today was absolutely phenomenal. And if you want to know how phenomenal this fight was, you probably ain't ever seen it, and I definitely ain't ever seen it in 35 years. We had a world championship referee, 60 world title fights he's done. He's been the number one referee for 2 years. Canelo, he's refereed 3 or 4 times, and he said, I've never seen this in the history of my boxing career. And he said, they both got knocked over in the first round. They both went over together. So he counted them both. There was ups and downs in the fight. One was up, one was down, one was up, one was down. And then in the last round, in the fifth round, the Pakistani kid knocked him spark out. Cracking fight. I will have it up on my channel very soon as well. I said last week, I believe we can change a lot in Pakistan. Listen, we know it's their number one sport, cricket, but let's put the bats down and start putting on gloves.
Fair enough, mate. And I saw a clip of you training with a young girl on the pads. I was really impressed with it. She looked really good. Tell me about the talent. Is there good boxing talent out there?
I mean, I've got to talk about the family here because the family were from a little village. They had to move into the city because the mother was the first Muslim in Pakistan to become a boxer. The mother was a boxer, the father was a boxer, and all the children are fighters now. It's an amazing family. I don't know if it's ever been done before that the whole family box, the whole family. They all hold gold medals. Yes, there's a lot of raw talent here. And not, listen, we got to realise they are fighting people. You don't realise it, but they're fighting people. And, mate, they've got heart in abundance. Listen, they're so respectful. If you tell them to run 10 mile, they're going to run 10 mile. And, you know, they're very, very regimental on what they do, training-wise and things.
What have they made of your teaching style? Obviously, you've worked with a lot of fighters over the years. Of course, you were a fighter yourself, a rough and ready fighter, always ready to fight. You've also worked with some good fighters in the UK, and a lot of them actually still ring you for advice. What have they made of your teaching style and the style of, like, England, Ireland, etc.?
Love it. Absolutely love it. I keep things simple. I've got a CV as long as my arm, so I've got no reason to try and impress people. And try and make it look as though I know something. How can I say it? Listen, I'll just keep boxing simple. You know, I keep reiterating to it. They're showing Joshua how to throw a double jab right and left hook. I mean, he won't even hit Usyk one punch. So I don't know why they tell him to throw four punches. So it's all about the foundation first, the feet, then the movement, and then you start using the arms. And like I say, people need to go back to the basics. And with these fighters here, you know, bringing them back to the basics. But listen, we all know that you can't open someone up and put a big heart in them or a big pair of balls, you know. And like I say, they've got an abundance here. So you've got a lot of raw talent here. I mean, you see them on the streets, on the motorways, and playing cricket, you know, with two bricks and a cricket bat, you know. They ain't got much here, but they're good fighters.
Yeah. And of course, Peter, you had a tough journey into boxing as well. You were up against it a lot of the time. So in a sense, you can probably relate to that struggle, can't you, and what they've got to do and the journey they've got to take.
Yes, I can relate to it. And listen, what you got to realise is we've had fighters in the UK or around the world that have been very, very well promoted. And then all of a sudden, you know, they get beat. But I think when you've got kids with raw talent and there's loads you can build on, I think the world's their oyster. And, the Kuwaiti kid who came over today, listen, he had 10 white collar fights. He ended up fighting a Pakistani international. He had 99 knockouts. He had 107 fights. Yeah, 99 knockouts, right? He'd only lost 5 fights. Yeah, in international all around the world. He was half set up. The kid was a gold medalist. Kid was a gold medalist. So, things work out for the best. And I just got a phone call not long after from the Kuwaiti, one of the princes in Kuwait. He's just invited me out to Kuwait. Very soon I'm going out there with Canelo's brother. So it's crazy how things work out. Everything, all of a sudden, like, he seems to be coming together now for me. And it's been a while, 3.5 years away from boxing. I think it's done me the world of good. I've come back and I sound like Tyson Fury. This is the trip I needed. I needed to get away, do things on my own. I come out here absolutely on my own. You know, I'll never come out here with anyone. I'm not out here to represent anyone. I'm out here just on my own. Just doing my own thing, so any promoters in the UK looking for someone to advise their fighters or, you know, not even just advise their fighters, give advice in general, you know, I'm always here. And listen, I'm a straight talker, I'm a straight shooter, that's not going to change, but, you know, at the same time, I'm going to calm down a little bit and, you know, just go with the flow with boxing.
Yeah, I mean, over the years, we've had some good debates. We don't always agree, but we always have a really good debate and discussion. You know, you're boxing inside and out. And at the end of the day, that's the sort of knowledge that you can put on to these people that are coming through, isn't it? I mean, they're probably not.
Do you know what? I'll be honest with you. you know, these people don't know boxing like they do in the UK, but I've had some beautiful messages from the UK. You know, big, big promoters, big fighters, ex-world champions, world champions still today, saying this is where you need to be. You need to be in the game. If you ain't got the most knowledge in the game, you've got to be one with one of the most knowledge in the game. You know, listen again, it's not about whatever amateur fights and 58 pro fights. My experience comes from sparring all around the world, you know, being in gyms all the time from 10 o'clock in the morning to 10 o'clock at night, listening to promoters, listening to managers. So I've got it from every angle, you know, and I understand it from every angle. So it's, I believe I can give a lot back, you know what I mean? But, you know, I've done an interview earlier and I was talking and the interviewer said to me about, you know, people puff up their chests on Instagram and all that. I said, but that's the joke of it all, is it's a hard game. It's a hard game, boxing. And people don't take it serious sometimes. And you're never going to become an elite fighter if you're just interested in looking good on the pads on Instagram. And I'm not a big believer in pads. I'm not a big believer in pads. And I think I'm going to bring a new dynamic to boxing because I find all these trainers want to make themselves look good. I mean, I know Ben Davis has been under scrutiny lately about the way he spoke. Listen, I back him fully. I'm not saying every trainer in the UK is lazy, and I'm not saying every trainer in the UK, you know, are poor. I'm not saying that, you know, I'm not tarring everyone, but I'm telling you what, I would put 80% of them in that category without a doubt. If you ask me how many teachers in the UK, I'd have to go away and think about it. Maybe walk around Pakistan a couple of weeks and then come back and tell you. Because what I find with people, you know, I'm defending the man here. I mean, even Shane McGuigan's jumped on the bandwagon now, turning around and slagging him off. But yeah, he has got good fighters. Yeah. But listen, let me tell you something. There was only one Tyson Fury. They ain't produced another one. There's only ever been one Canelo. They ain't produced another one. There's only been one Floyd Mayweather. And if it was a miracle with trainers, yeah, in boxing, we'd have 10 Tyson Furies, wouldn't we? We ain't got 10 Tyson Furies. Listen, we can't, when we get a fighter, we can't open their belly and put a bigger heart in there, and we can't put a bigger pair of balls in that fighter, yeah? They've either got it or they ain't. And you can only work with what you got. So for me, all you're doing is adding to that fighter. Don't try and be a superstar. You know, just because you ain't got a CV, you're trying to make yourself look good on the pads and talk about yourself. It's not about yourself. It's about the fighter. They're the ones that do the work. They're the ones that do all the hard work. Yes, listen, you've got to mould with that fighter. I'm not disputing that. And I'm not disputing a coach taking, you know, the credit with the fighter. But let's be honest, get out of the camera and let the fighter talk. That's my opinion. Because, you know what? When they get to a certain level, yeah, you do add certain bits. But you're carrying water, mate, and you're carrying a spray bottle and you're carrying a towel. Because for me, if the fighter ain't going to get in there and do what he's got to do, it don't matter how good you are.
Yeah, some very, very interesting points, Peter, as always. Just tell us finally, what's the next step for you then, mate, in for this venture, for this? What's you and the Pakistan Cricket, Pakistan Boxing Board, what's the next step for you guys together?
The next step is I'll fly back. You know, 2022, I said it's going to be my year. I've struggled, like I said. I've opened up to everyone. I said I've been struggling. 2022, I said, will be my year. I never knew I was coming to Pakistan 2 weeks ago. You know, and I just got on a plane and I went, yeah. Listen, if you don't take chances, you don't ever get anywhere in life, in my opinion. Tyson Fury said to me, I invited you to Vegas and you ended up in Pakistan. You know what I mean? But I said, you know me, Tyson. You know, been speaking to Tyson over the last few days and been having a good laugh and things like that. And you know what? I'm doing positive things again. So people want to be around me being positive. So, yeah, I fly back. On the 27th, I've got filming with Channel 5. I'm doing something on prison with Channel 5. End of the month, I've got something else on. So I'm starting to become busy again. And I'm back. I'm back where I want to be. I'm back to what I love. I was angry with boxing. But why was I angry with boxing? Boxing's been good to me. Boxing's been very good to me. Boxing's kept me on the straight and narrow. Boxing's helped me through life. You know, not many people, like your mum leaves, you lose your sister, you lose your brother. It kept me on the straight and narrow. And, you know, I owe a lot to boxing and I want to give a lot back to boxing. And, you know, some people become born again Christians, some people change their religions. But for me, boxing is my religion. Boxing is my life. And I fought my whole life. And listen, I'm not going to stop fighting now. I'm back. And I'm back to try and produce world champions. I believe I can do that. The mistakes I made, I believe, and I can help other people. I don't just want to be a coach. I don't even know what exact role I want yet, but I definitely believe I can be a decent advisor. You know, all I'm, you know, because I would like to be here to help the fighters. You know, and you know, who's to know, a manager? I don't know. I like advisor because I think it's nice to go in a gym, watch kids. You know, I'm saying kids, but even adults, and just say, look, I think you're making that mistake, this mistake. You know, it's nice to have another set of eyes. You know, everybody's got to stop using their ego. And, you know, no, I don't let you near my fighter. Because I bring my fighters everywhere because I'm confident in what I do. So, I'm looking forward to it. I'm buzzing again. You can see I've got the flow again. I'm excited with what the future holds. But, you know, even Joshua, you know, I'd love to see Joshua beat Usyk. I do think it'd be a clever move. He lets Tyson Fury take that spot. And it gives himself a little bit more time. And if Fury comes through the Usyk fight, it's a massive fight with Joshua and Fury, which everyone wants to see. No one's that interested in Joshua Usyk too. Everyone's interested in Fury, Joshua, if he comes through Usyk. But I will say this. Joshua, I think he's got to sort himself out mentally before he sorts himself out physically. And the problem is, we can all talk about being humble and just going back to the gym and looking good. But for me, he's got to have a deep look inside. He's got to get the right people around him. Because if I was training him for Usyk, I'd have been tucking him up in bed every night with a hot chocolate and telling him what he's got to do. I wouldn't have been gallivanting all over the world. And, you know, for me, they lost their control there a little bit. Eddie Hearn has done an absolute amazing job with Anthony Joshua. I've got to give him that. But for someone that was a gold medalist at the Olympics and don't even know how to hold properly, don't even know how to manoeuvre his feet properly. And they're talking about, technically, he's changing. I told you about elastic, bombastic, fantastic. Load of rubbish. Throw a left hook and you're bringing his arms around here. No, we're just doing it for conditioning. I don't care what you're doing it for. When you've got someone's technique, keep their technique right. It's about repetition, repetition, repetition. Yeah, you keep doing it. Boxing is monotonous. Boxing is monotonous. You throw a 1, 2, 3, that's it. An uppercut every now and again. But how many times do people hit someone with three punch combination? In a heavyweight division, if you hit someone with three punches, you're knocking them spark out, you know? And it don't happen often. Don't happen often. So I've gone on a little bit of a rant there. But you know why? Because I've got passion. I've got passion for people like Anthony Joshua because he's doing boxing. He does boxing great in England. But for me, the people that are around him, cheerleaders and backslappers, ask them for their CVs. He sacked Robert McCracken. I don't think he's involved anymore. Ask for the rest of the people he's got around some CVs and see what they've done in boxing. And see, you know, listen, if you're going to ask someone to do something, if you're going to teach someone to do something, right, the thing is in boxing, people tell people to do something, right? And when you ask them the answer, yeah, they don't know what the answer is. Why are you asking me that for? I will have the answer for anything. I'll show someone what to do. Do you understand? So, listen, I won't only tell them how to do it. I'll teach them how to do it. And then I'll say, this is why you're doing it. So there's three components there. But the problem is, people only use one component because, like I say, there's no CV. Get a job in McDonald's, yeah? And you wash the toilets, yeah? They're going to show you how to wash the toilets before you start washing them, yeah? In boxing, just go and get a license. Just go and get a license. You know, there's no apprenticeship. Where is the apprenticeship in boxing? There's no apprenticeship. Listen, the black taxi driver, the geezer down the road can get a license. And for me, that's what I think Ben Davidson said. That's what he's saying. Listen, I'll tell you that. Ben Davison used to carry Billy Joe Saunders' bag, but he used to sit in the gym all day long and he used to watch and he used to pick things up all day long from day to night, because I was in the gym when he used to come in there. You know, he'd ask questions, he'd get knowledge. You know, I don't believe you've had to have been a fighter. Apparently he had a few when he was younger, but forget that. I don't think you'd have had to have been a fighter. I think if you can understand the sport, it's simple. And when you speak to someone like Ben Davison, he understands the sport. Watch Ben Davison on the pads on fire. Couple of shots, that's it. He don't throw 15, 20 punch combinations and then look at Instagram and say, look at me. He don't. I don't think he's like that. And for a young man to be training Tyson Fury at that young age, yeah, never lost his head. I mean, we've got Sugar Hill bowling about with no top on. What's all that about? What's all that about? He's just following Tyson about. He's a slapper. Listen. Manuel Stewart's a legend. Yeah? But Sugar Hill's no Manuel Stewart. You know, Tyson Fury, if my little girl trained him, would be world champion. No doubt about it. No doubt about it. Listen, we get superior people in the world, Aki. We get superior people, yeah? Like top sports people. Ronaldo, Messi, you know, Canelo, yeah? Tyson Fury, yeah? Usyk, Lemoshenko. We can't put the likes of Joshua and that in a category. I don't believe we can. I don't believe we can. And I think we could have chucked them boys in any era. In any era. You know, because you know why? You know why? Because they adapt. They're adaptable. They're adptable. So Tyson Fury is a little bit like one of them plugs you take on holiday. You can put an English adapter into it or you can put a foreign adapter into it. He adapts to whatever's in front of him. You know, I turned around and said to Matt Tyson, I said, listen, for the last Wilder fight, he was 60%. I said, he's going to have to get off the floor in that fight. Yeah? Do I know my boxing? Right? If he's like that for Usyk, Usyk beats him. Usyk beats him, right? Tyson Fury, 80 to 100% beats Usyk, in my opinion, right? But let me say this, you know, Joshua, is he good? Is he? No. Is he better than Usyk? No, he's not. Can Joshua beat Usyk? I think he can. But with the right teacher, not cheerleader, not trainer, not backslapper. Yeah, you still can tuck him up into bed with his hot chocolate as long as you're telling him a knowledgeable bedtime story. Before I finish, listen, again, this is no disrespect to trainers in England, you know, all trainers in England, yeah, right? Maybe the way Ben put it across, he was a little bit more arrogant to it. I'm not arrogant to that. But believe me, I do defend that. Definitely 80% in my opinion. There's maybe 20% in the UK. Why has Joshua got to go across the other side of the pond to get an American voice and talk about an American voice? We should have these people in the UK. We've got the best fighters in the UK. So why has he not got someone in the UK? You know, boxing's at a high level in the UK now. You know, so you know, that's why I've come out here to Pakistan, because no one listens to me in the UK.
All right, Pete. Well, enjoy the rest of your evening, my friend. And we'll catch up as soon as you get back. Give the bell and we'll catch up, mate. And we'll move on to the next
stage. That's the top and bottom of it. That's the top and bottom of it.